An ordinary man, insurance executive, 45 years old, stumbles to his death on a subway platform in New York City. Or does he? Unbeknownst to his wife or child, his brain is rescued from the accident scene by a secret branch of the United States government and put into the body of an artificially produced 26-year-old man who has the strength of Superman, the speed of Michael Jordan, and the grace of Fred Astaire. The only catch, under penalty of death, he can never let anyone from his past know he is still alive. And that, my friends, is a problem. For this man is desperately in love with his wife, his daughter, and his former life.
Child, things are gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter.
A nightmare about that mad scientist Don Cornelius.
Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter. Someday now, we'll put it together and we'll get it all done. Someday when your head is much lighter.
Lighter? My head's removable.
Someday now, we'll walk in the rays of a beautiful sun. Someday when the world is much brighter. Everybody. Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier.
Why can't I at least pick my own song to sing in the shower?
La, 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 la. Good morning, Mr. Wiseman.
Says you.
And to what do we owe this burst of good cheer?
I'm dying from the monotony, Doc. Every morning it's the same thing. 6 a.m., the shutters open, the sun comes in, you serenade me, and then you feed me gruel, and you exercise me till it's afternoon. And then it's some kind of vegetable swill for lunch, more exercise, dinner, and bed. Every day, day in and day out.
Haven't you heard? Variety is the spice of life. Wake me up at 7:17 sometime. Go wild, put some raisins in my bran. Bosco in my milk. I need a change, Doc.
And a change you shall have.
You're kidding.
I kid you not. Tomorrow we're going on a trip to the mountains.
A trip to the mountains?
For survival training.
Survival training?
Sure, you're gonna love it. We drop you from a plane smack in the middle of the Adirondacks without food, water, or compass, and see if you can find your way back to civilization.
Boy, you do no fun.
And to keep things interesting, my entire staff will be out there stalking you.
Stalking me?
Mm-hmm. With these.
Really, you spoil me. Now, forgive me for telling you something you already know, but I think it bears reiterating. I'm not bulletproof.
Really? You sure? My God! You survived. And that was a really tough weather duty paint.
Do it again. Try to remember who I am.
We only want what we can have. And what we can't have, yeah.
Mom, my 35-year-old ex-convict boyfriend is here to take me away, but he wanted to meet you before we take off for the state line. Would that be okay?
Hi, honey.
Mom, I've been calling you for like 5 minutes. It's about to start.
I have to keep at it. Go ahead and watch it without me.
But it's an award show, Mom. You can't watch it alone. You need somebody to mock the proceedings with.
I know. But my test is tomorrow night.
Relax. How hard could it be? I mean, Jenny's mom, she passed her real estate test on the first try, and she thinks Wheel of Fortune is educational television. Look, I think I hear the opening number. I gotta go.
Hello? Hello? Anybody out there listening? Hey, big brother. Aren't we taking a class trip to the mountains today? Okay, play hard to get. But I'm getting hungry. And I'm getting lonely. And I'm getting bored.
Mom, I need you to sign my geometry, and I need you to give me money for my class pictures. And remember, you have to bake cookies for the orchestra bake sale.
What is there to be afraid of? There's nothing to be afraid of. It's just a multiple choice test. And life is a multiple choice test all by itself. If you're lucky enough to live in a free country. For instance, the question of the moment is, should I, Lisa Wiseman, A, go upstairs and shower and dress, B, drink some coffee, or C, lay back down? Good answer.
Excuse me. Excuse me. You live here?
Hi. Oh, thank goodness. You work with Dr. Morris?
No, I don't work with anybody. I live next door. Do you live here, or are you... You seem very, casual for a robber.
No, I live here.
Oh, good, because your front door is wide open. You can hear the alarm for 3 blocks away.
Yeah, I know.
So then, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Why don't you shut off the alarm?
Don't know how.
You forget the code?
You know how it is.
Okay. Any idea why the alarm company hasn't shown up?
Nope. But I would think somebody'd come by pretty soon.
Well, I hope so. Well, your place is very, unique.
Thank you. I appreciate you being so cool about this.
Yeah, well, if it doesn't stop within half an hour, I'm calling the police.
Right.
Mrs. Wiseman?
Perhaps. I'm sorry, your name?
Isley. Forgive me for ringing your bell so early in the morning. Actually, I'm here to try and locate Mr. Wiseman. Michael Wiseman?
Oh, well, I don't know who you are or what you want, but my husband passed away 10 months ago.
I know that, Mrs. Wiseman. But I also know he's sought you out from time to time since then. All I'm asking is, if you should stop by, would you please give me a call?
Doc?
Mr. Wiseman? Mr. Wiseman? Your friend, Dr. Morris, sent us here. He asked us to bring you.
Bring me? Bring me where, the mountains? And aren't you guys carrying this Lyme disease thing a little far?
He told us to come here, shut off the alarm, and bring you. Please come with us.
All right. But do me a couple of favors. One, lower the guns till we get outside. We don't want to get any paint in the pool. Two, radio ahead and let them know I'm hungry. Real hungry. And angry. Really angry. But nothing a little chocolate cake couldn't fix. Look, I'm not expecting miracles. Just take your best shot. Even if all I get are a couple extra croutons on my salad, it's worth it to me. All right, show me your wheels, boys. Let's get this show on the road. Hey, if we're headed to the mountains, how come we're still in the city and headed south? Hey, listen, back to the food thing for a minute. How about we stop and grab a couple of breakfast sandwiches? You know, couple slices of highly processed bread with eggs, sausages, some fried potatoes on there. We could even pick one up for the doc. He'd like that, don't you think?
Yeah, sounds good.
That's what I thought.
Let's see what kind of paint you're back. Dr. Morris didn't send you! Where is Dr. Morris? I'll tell you!
Pardon me.
Sorry to be so gruff, Mr. Bender, but I'm on a very tight schedule. The organization I'm working for has reason to believe that since his untimely passing, you've had intermittent contact with Michael Weissman. My people are prepared to pay $1 million if you can facilitate a meeting between us and the gentleman in question.
But the gentleman in question is dead.
$1.5 million is as high as I'm authorized to go.
Hello? I'd like to report a kidnapping. No, I'm not the subject's parent. We're talking about an adult male, Dr. Theodore Yes, I'll slow down. Sorry. Morris. M-O-R-R-I-S. Of course I'm sure he was kidnapped. He didn't show up for work today. Well, no, I haven't called his home. I don't have that number. Yes, I consider myself a close friend. My name is... Forget it.
Welcome to National Information Assistance. What city?
New York.
What state?
New York.
What listing?
Dr. Theodore Morris.
We show 6 listings for your request. First listing.
6 listings?
Area code 212-555.
Wait a second, I don't have a pencil. I'll call you back.
Excuse me, do you have a pencil I could borrow for like 5 minutes?
$0.63.
No, I meant to borrow.
$0.63.
You don't understand. I just want to
borrow. $0.63? Man.
The way things go, you get so low, struggle to find your skin. Oh, hey ho, look out below.
$0.63.
Forget that. I want a pen.
You sure? $1.98.
Sure, I'm sure. I'm loaded. And a pad. Gee, are those peanut butter cups you got back there?
All right. I'm looking for a Dr. Theodore Morris. You don't have a doctor? Just a Ted. All right, thank you anyway.
This is a Wiseman resident. We can't come to the phone right now, so please leave a message at the beep.
First right, then a left, another right, second door, talk to the officer on duty. Next.
Hi, I've got two things.
First thing?
Well, I'd like to report a missing person.
Name?
The missing man's name is Dr. Theodore Morris.
And you are?
Unimportant.
Unimportant?
Look, I've already tried calling this in, and you people keep getting hung up on who I am instead of who the missing person is. I'm not missing. Dr. Theodore Morris is, and he's a very important guy.
A very important guy?
Very. He works for the government doing top secret work. I mean, I don't know who you call to check those things out, but I'm sure you do, and you should call and check. Dr. Theodore Morris, he's missing, and it's bad.
This, Dr. Morris, he wouldn't be your doctor, would he?
We are involved in a highly sensitive project, yes. But I really can't say more than that.
I had a hunch. Let's move on to the second thing.
Excuse me?
You said there were two things.
Oh, yeah. Would it be all right if I just hung around here for a while?
Well, we generally don't encourage that kind of thing. No.
The reason I ask is, it's hard to explain, but if I stay in one place long enough, the people who keep tabs on me will eventually track me down.
I see. And you want that. Can't they track you down outside?
Well, sure they could. Of course they could. But I've also got these other fellows after me.
I'm gonna guess. Bad fellows.
Yeah. And I just figured that if I stayed in here, the good guys could find me, but the bad guys would stay away.
Well, that's sound thinking, my friend. But unfortunately, the only people allowed in here are people who are reporting crimes or people who have committed crimes and are under arrest. Now, what I'm going to do is this. I'm going to ask one of the officers upstairs, make some calls and see if there really is a Dr. Morris. Because frankly, you sound to me like you could use a doctor of some sort.
Thank you.
Take a seat over there. Give me a couple minutes.
This is a Wiseman resident. We can't come to the phone right now, so please leave a message at the beep.
Lisa, it's Roger. I just got your message. I should be at the office.
Roger, I'm here. I'm just screening my calls. Thank you so much for getting back to me.
Oh, no. My pleasure.
So, today's the big day, huh? When is test time?
It's not until 7:30. That's not why I called. I had a very odd experience this morning that...
Man with a business card asked you about Michael.
How did you know?
Mom, there's some guy out front, and it felt like he was watching me the whole time I walked up the walk.
Lock the door.
I'm coming right over.
Sir. Sir. Fellas upstairs made a couple of calls. You wouldn't be Mr. Wiseman, would you?
What if I were?
And you've been straight with me all along. Turns out your friend is an important fella. And apparently, he knows a lot of other important fellas, and they've been looking for you.
Well, I figured they had to be.
Come on, let's go upstairs, talk to some people, see if we can't get this whole thing straightened out.
Well, you're a very popular guy, and from what I hear, very special.
It's nothing really, just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Well, I think these guys will be able to help you, Mr. Wiseman.
Don't damage him!
It's Uncle Roger.
I wonder what he's honking about. Why doesn't he get out of the car and come to the door? Why doesn't he come in?
This is a Wiseman resident. We can't come to the phone right now, so please leave a message at the beep.
Lisa, it's Roger. Listen, I'm sure you're going to think I'm being paranoid,
but I think someone followed me over here. So maybe, rather than my coming in, it might make more sense if you came out and got into my car.
Roger, I have this test in 3 hours that I have been trying to study for all day.
Don't you think it might be possible for you?
I believe we may all be in danger.
I'll get the coats.
I'll grab your books.
He gave me this.
Where are we going?
Well, he found you too. What does it mean?
Well, I fear it's all some hideous, terrible mistake. The man to whom I spoke seemed unwilling or incapable of accepting the idea that Michael is gone.
Isn't the point of having a car to move? I mean, if some guy's following us, trailing us, I mean, you're making his job a lot easier by just sitting here in the driveway.
Heather, wait a second. I'm starting to think that maybe we're overreacting. I mean, a strange man came to my door. He didn't hurt me. He didn't threaten me. Yeah, he spooked me a little, sure, but he also gave me his phone number. No, if he was up to no good, he wouldn't give me his phone number, would he?
I ain't got a point there.
Why don't we call him?
And tell him what?
You can begin by telling him where Mr. Wiseman is. There's nothing to be afraid of. I just need some information. Once I have it, I'll be on my way. May I join you?
Get out of the car! Go to Gretchen's and stay there! Don't come home till I call you!
May I just ask a question? Who is it you're protecting? Your government? How do you think the organization I work for heard of your husband, if not through someone in your government who was forced or bribed or just sought to impress by sharing this deep secret?
What secret? I don't know what you're talking about. My husband sold insurance. He had nothing to do with the government. He voted, he paid taxes, that's it. We're just regular people. I have a little girl. I'm supposed to take my realtor's test in 3 hours. Winter's coming, so tomorrow I have to rummage through the basement and find the snow tires, and I don't know what a snow tire looks like. That's it, that's who I am.
And I'm even less.
Wanna see where he lives? Where your husband's lived since he died?
Well, go fish.
What is so humorous?
No, nothing. It is not humorous. It's sad or it's sick. I just can't think of anything else to do but laugh. This is it. This is where my husband has been living?
So we've been led to believe, yes. Ever since his death, 10 months ago.
Pardon me, but did you hear what you just said? I mean, listen to yourself. You're not making any sense.
This is unbelievable. Do you know who lives here? I do. A man by the name of Newman. Not Wiseman. Newman.
No, Wiseman.
No, Newman.
Dr. Morris. Doc.
Wow.
Doc, you lying bastard, you do watch me.
Oh, this is hysterical. You have obviously confused my late husband with Mr. Newman.
Mrs. Wiseman.
If you knew how completely different they were. Michael was so solid, and Mr. Newman is, well, it's like this place. Strange. And he works for the government.
Yes, I know. The IRS. No. Yes.
I even helped him with an investigation at the firm I work for. Although, I'd appreciate it if you kept that strictly between thee and me.
And what's with the spaces?
We were led to believe Mr. Wiseman might be biologically volatile. That he might carry some disease or pestilence.
Right.
Look, once and for all, Mr. Wiseman isn't carrying much of anything these days. And if he were, trust me, that woman would be dead. She's kissed him.
I am leaving now. Roger, my test starts in 1 hour and 10 minutes, and I am not missing it. And as for you, you are obviously the victim of a hoax, no doubt perpetrated by Mr. Newman, perhaps relating to his IRS work. I don't know. That's not my problem. My problem is that I don't like strangers coming to my door and frightening me and my daughter. And I don't like men parked in front of my house, watching my comings and goings, and I don't appreciate people sullying the memory of my husband with nonsensical stories about where he lives now that he's dead. So as soon as I get home, I am calling the police, and I am going to give them your phone number, and I will be providing them with your description. Roger, come on.
Isn't she great?
Do you know a Dr. Theodore Morris? Dr. Morris is a scientist who committed his life to building an artificial man. Your government financed him to the tune of billions of dollars, and apparently, sometime late last year, he succeeded. Save for one small thing. He could not synthesize a brain.
That he needed to transplant from a living human being.
Oh my God.
I'll bet you watch lots of shows that aren't listed in the TV guide.
I'm deadly serious, Mrs. Wiseman. There was one problem Dr. Morris couldn't solve.
One obstacle he couldn't overcome.
Don't tell her. And it forced him into an ethical dilemma that threatened to derail the project.
No. All of his work was about to go down the drain. Without a mind, the beautiful body he built would never live. The salvation, Mrs. Wiseman, was none other than...
Yes.
Watch out!
Yes. Yes, yes, sir. No, sir, they're not being very cooperative.
Yes, sir, I understand. Yeah. Yes, Mr. Leflin.
Leflin?
I'll meet you over at 78th Street.
$3 million is my final offer.
$3 million?
Come on, Roger.
All right. It's a $1,200 suit. The least they could do is pay for the dry cleaning.
Fine, sure.
$78 and second.
Yes, I'm here for Mr. Leflin.
Yes, sir. The memorial's on the second floor.
The memorial?
Do you want to sign the guest book, or did you do that at the funeral yesterday morning?
Yesterday, funeral. Thank you. I believe you've been looking for me. Michael Wiseman. You know, I'm sorry I would have worn a suit and one of those Toxic Avenger costumes, but I didn't know I was coming till the last minute. Oh, look, it's about to start. Shame. So here's the deal. If you don't take me to Dr. Morris right now, I'm gonna stand up and tell all these nice people I heard you talking to their dead friend on the phone today.
I'd be happy to.
This is insane. Makes no sense. My hair is wet. Wasted the last couple of hours on nonsense. I haven't had anything to eat. I'm gonna fail. I'm just setting myself up to fail. Maybe you should just take me home, and I'll take the test the next time you offer it.
No.
What did you say?
I said no. I'm not participating in this little game that you're playing with yourself. I'm taking you to the test. I'm going to wait outside until you finish the test. Now, you want to go inside and hide in the bathroom, that's your business. But I'm doing my job as your friend and getting you there.
Roger, I don't think I like your tone.
Well, you don't have to like it. You just have to listen to it. I know you're scared. Scared is where I live. But do you really want to go home and tell Heather that you just couldn't get it together to take this test? I mean, that'd be like failing two tests. And that is not the Lisa that I know. She would rather go home and tell her daughter that she failed than tell her daughter that she ran away.
You play very dirty, Mr. Bender.
When I have to.
Okay, I think that's quite enough, Mr. Wiseman. Step away from the chair. Dr. Morris, if you'll swivel around in your chair, you'll see that I have a gun trained on your creation, and I'm prepared to use it. And while I know it won't kill him, we both know it'll do some damage. So, perhaps you'd like to take a moment and reconsider our proposition.
Let me be clear. This is not my creation. I have no creation. And as for your proposition, I won't accept because I can't accept. I am completely unfamiliar with the procedure you're asking me to perform.
You leave me no choice.
I'd like to suggest a choice. As a courtesy, before you shoot me, could somebody tell me what's going on here?
I'm giving you three to reconsider, Dr. Morris. One.
What's going on here is an attempt at a misguided business proposition. Mr. Laughlin here is under the mistaken impression that I've transplanted a human brain into a man-made Superman.
Two. What do you mean, Mr. Laughlin? He's not Mr. Laughlin. In fact, I heard him speaking to the late Mr. Laughlin not more than an hour ago.
Three.
Wait! I've been listening. The doctor's right. There's no need to add a charge of murder on top of everything else. It seems we've been misinformed, son. Hand me the gun.
I'm sorry, Father.
You two are father and son? Okay, now I'm completely confused.
Not nearly as confused as we have been, apparently. The woman that I was led to believe is your wife, apparently is not. A man that was supposed to be your closest friend knows very little about you and this biological threat you supposedly represent. Clearly groundless. A man of my age and experience should know better than believe stories told to him by his friends in the government. But when you're one of the richest men in the world, and you hear whispers, rumors, that there exists a man who could give you what no money can buy, a new life. When you wake up in the morning racked with pain, when every breath you draw is a chore, well, you are determined to find this man and convince him to do this extraordinary thing for you. First, you offer him money, billions. When that doesn't work, you find what you think he values most, and you threaten to destroy it.
That's why you sent your men after me.
You even stage your own death, arrange your own funeral, to facilitate the operation you know the doctor will perform. It was a good plan. Had there actually been such a man who could do such a thing. But clearly, on so many levels, we were profoundly misinformed. Let our optimism get the best of us, huh? Well, son, I think it's time to send our friends home. Time for you to go back downstairs to the ceremony. Time for me to contemplate what's next.
It's not going to be as simple as that. I was kidnapped. My colleague here stalked. People were hurt. I will be going to the authorities as soon as I leave here.
Well, we all have to do what we all have to do. Nevertheless, our business is concluded. There's nothing more to talk about. I suppose I'll have to find another way to solve my problem.
Do you believe the arrogance of that? Just because he's one of the wealthiest men in the world, he thinks he can get away with this whole thing. And he doesn't even care if you go to the cops. By the way, can you go to the cops?
I don't see how. Our work is supposed to be top secret. You're not even supposed to exist.
So that's it. They get off scot-free.
Excuse me. Dr. Morris. I completely understand your anger and outrage. But before you call the authorities, I was wondering if we couldn't sit down and see if there was some way we could compensate you. Compensate both of you for any inconvenience you may have suffered.
Dad, what have you done?
I guess the awful truth is, no one ever gets through this life scot-free. You call an ambulance. Let me see if there's anything I can do.
Hi.
Hi.
You're just getting home?
Well, I had to take my test.
Oh, I thought you might chicken out.
What are you talking about? I would never chicken out. In fact, I think I aced it.
No kidding?
No kidding. Actually, Uncle Roger helped me get ready.
Uncle Roger? I didn't think he could help anybody with anything.
Oh, yeah. Actually, he can be quite helpful. He has to be. Ooh, things will get brighter.
Together and we'll get it out. Give me a sign.